Today I'm going to do a quick video on making guitar cables. My rig has quite a few different patch cables and extended run cables for interconnects between gear, and I thought I'd put together a quick video on the things that I have found while doing this. And this also will tie into another video that I'm going to redo on noise reduction and things to cabling is a prime consideration when you're looking to prevent noise from getting into your guitar signal. So let's take a quick look here. What I'm showing you here in my hand is a cable called from a company called Gepco. It's X-band cable. It's extremely low capacitance. Lower capacitance than, say, Mogami 2524 cable. I've used both, so I have experience with both of those, and I just prefer the Gepco. I'm using such long cable lengths that extra low capacitance really helps preserve the highs of my signal. So you can't get back something that you lost through cabling. So the idea here is to prevent the loss in the first place by using lower capacitance cable. So what I've done is kind of stripped away the end of the cable here, and as I'll have to manually zoom in here to show you, this particular cable, as a lot of cables are, you'll see this outer conductor, after you peel back this, strip off this cable casing, outer casing, and you'll notice that the inner conductor, the shield, is woven. Now this differs from on the Gepco and a lot of cables from what you'll find on Mogami. Mogami has actually a spiral wrap around. They take and this outer conductor is wrapped in a single direction, and it actually makes for easier handling when you go to make cables. When you have this woven piece, you have to actually pull it apart very carefully on one side so that you can kind of bundle it and roll it together for that outer shield conductor. Now, both the Mogami and the Gepco have this inner casing, this black piece here, which I've stripped away. This is conductive. So if you're using this cable, be careful that you do want to strip this back from the inner conductor. This is an insulator also, this white piece here. And so what I have done is strip this back as if I were going to make a cable end. And so normally I would bend this out and twist this and then solder it in terms so that I get a tinning effect on it before I actually solder it onto the plug. Be very careful because this gets very hot and it will melt that inner insulator. So if you're new to soldering, practice first. Next thing in terms of this, this is very thin. I've got a piece here that I'll show you. Hopefully you can see this. Let me turn it around. But you can see that it's a very, very thin piece of material. That comes off, as I mentioned, and then strip back just a small section. Twist these, tin the end of it by heating it and applying some solder just to keep all these wires bundled together. That's something else you need to be considerate of, is that just one of these small pieces of wire, one frayed wire touching here, can cause all kinds of noise and havoc, short the signal out, that kind of thing. So you want to be very careful in as you make these ends that you get capture all of those small conductors. Same here. And then when you solder them on, that's the next step. What I have here is an area or a piece of section of patch cable that I made. And I have two different kinds of connectors on it. One is the small mini connector, which is very short. These particular connectors do not have a mechanical clamp to the actual conductor. And so what that means is the stress on this connection is extremely, it's very sensitive to being pulled out. So what I have done is after I've connected this, soldered these in, since I have no connector that comes back here and clamps like on this right angle piece on the other end, I've applied some heat shrink tubing and shrunk that down extremely tightly so that it provides that mechanical grip. So let's take a look at the other end. This is the typical right angle plug that I use. Again, lots of sources for these, Redco, Orange County Speaker, you name it, there's a lot of them out there. This actually has an interconnect conductor insulator that slides up here, and so that fits in here like this. But again, what you'll see is how I've shrunk that heat shrink tubing down extremely tightly. That provides some additional mechanical rigidity because this particular conductor actually extends out to about here. This other conductor only runs to about here. And at the end out here, there's you slide the cable in and then clamp it around the cable like this. So right in here you might be able to see the indentations of that. So that provides some mechanical rigidity as well as the heat shrink. Now some cables you might see commercially, they take the extra step where once this piece has been connected, they'll put heat shrink along the outside, shrink that down so it provides some additional. I've never had any problems with my cables pulling apart or anything, but I'm not yanking them around by the ends, so I'm fairly careful about how I work with them. Now the tools you'll need obviously is a soldering iron and some solder, but I found a soldering aid like this where it has a right angle and fairly sharp point. Be careful of those. This helps me to pull that this braiding apart. I also picked up one of these cable stripper machines or devices at Radio Shack or someplace like that. Yeah, I think it is actually a Radio Shack. And this actually helps peel this outer cabling off. A lot of times they use this in networking for coaxial cables. And I don't find it very good for guitar cables because this inner connector here, the conductor, is actually much larger diameter than what you find in coax cable. So while it may not be great for these particular types of cables, guitar cables, it does an excellent job of being able to strip this outer cable just by applying it like this and then turning it around the cable like this, and that slide, it has a little blade in there that you adjust the depth on, and you can adjust it so it just slices through this outer shield or outer casing, and then that comes off, and then you can proceed to make the cable ends. So that's about it. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll catch you in the next video.